that great testimonies of faith are made of. Notice they do live. Some of them are in your church, probably. You're probably one of them. Know them. Be inspired by them. That's number four. Number five. Keep reminding yourself that the greener grass on the other side of the fence is not nourishing. It's deceptively green. It is nutritionally, in fact, bankrupt. Looks better, tastes better in short run. It doesn't nourish the soul. And if you jump the fence and go to that nice, peaceful, serene, idyllic, pasture-land grass, you will near your grave feeling massively inauthentic. Your soul will begin to shrivel up, and you'll begin to think you sold your soul to a pasture. Don't go there. The grass that God intends you to eat is the grass of ministry. The deepest lesson, the deepest nourishing things in life are in hard places and hard times. Nobody has ever said in my hearing in 64 years, I went deep with God in the bright sunny days and drifted from Him in the dark days. I have never heard that testimony. It's always the bright sunny days were tempting days, luring days, drifting days, and the hard days drove me down into Jesus. That's what you got to preach to yourself when the grass starts to look really green on the bright side of the fence. Number six, take breaks into a bit of heaven now and then. It's needed by most. I can't tell you what those breaks should look like, how long they should be, or how short they should be, or what you should be doing with them. But there come seasons in your life, probably, besides the Sabbath principle of the weekend, that everybody should find a way to observe. 1 in 7, turn off the steam. You're not God. And there come those seasons when the soul needs to be tested, the vision needs to be tested. God will make that plain. Don't be afraid of stepping back and taking a break, but be careful of this. Don't turn your life into a break. In this life, it's hard. In this life, it's disappointing. In this life, it's pain. And if there's a break, it's a break to keep. It's a break to get yourself oriented. It's a break to find the pace to finish the race. It's a break to fall. Number 7. Help each other with stories of God's faithfulness and with prophetic words of God that arrive at the appointed hour to sustain. See if I explain to you what I mean. 1993, I, with our church, walked through the darkest days of our 30 years together. And among other means, God sustained me with people's timely, Bible-saturated words. And I'm just saying, be this for each other and avail yourself of this. Do not think you can make this ministry trek towards heaven on your own. God appoints not only that we go here, this glorious, infallible, inerrant, God-inspired word every day, absolutely essential to my soul, Bob. It is to yours. He also ordains that this come to us, not just like this, but like this. Somebody else is over there going deep with God. And I need him. I need her. Come to me. Talk to me. I'm not seeing much. I am so discouraged. I can hardly read. Talk to me. You got it? We must be there for each other. When one is weak, another is strong. When one is blank and hopeless, another's been given a ray of hope. That's not to be kept for yourself. It's been to go over here and land on this person at an appointed time. This is my understanding of prophecy. Just at an appointed golden moment, a God-given word arrives through this, into this, and light is given. Hope is given. So number seven is help each other with stories of God's faithfulness and with prophetic words of encouragement. I'll give you one example. No, I think I'll pass over. Just go to the last one. Give you an example of that. Last one, number eight. Remember, in summary, of all the others, it is more blessed to give than to receive. The devil will tell you otherwise. He will say a good night's sleep is better. Or watching this TV program is better. Or playing with your kids at 8:30 in spite of the suicidal call you just received is better. Paul Brand, who was a missionary surgeon to India, wrote this beautiful, I'll end with it and then give you a summary. Some people voluntarily take on suffering as an act of service. And these two find that pain can serve a higher end. I have met a few living saints in my time, men and women who at great personal pains and sacrifice have devoted themselves to the care of others. As I have watched these rare individuals in action, though, any thought of personal sacrifice fades away. I find myself envying, not pitying them. In the process of giving away life, they find it and achieve a level of contentment and peace virtually unknown in the rest of the world. That's what we want, isn't it? In giving our lives away, we want to find our lives and a kind of peace and contentment that the world cannot have or comprehend. So let me summarize these areas, and I'll pray. Number one, how is ministry possible in a life so permeated by pain, so permeated by disappointment in ministry? And it will always be this way. Lower your expectations while this world lasts through many afflictions we must enter the kingdom. Number one, marvel at the gospel. Number two, don't expect too much from people. Number three, look to God for stability and security and contentment. Number four, be inspired by examples of those who kept on giving in pain. Number five, realize or recall that greener grass is not nutritional. Number six, take breaks as needed, but don't turn your life into a break. Seven, help each other with words in season and out of season that point to Christ. And eight, remember the word of our Lord. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Father, my longing for